Good morning and welcome to our service this morning here in Cuba, New York. Greet all who are in person today and also those who are watching online. I have a few announcements before we get started. I do want you to know that we are receiving the America for Christ offering. And as you know, that supports many of the ministries that our denomination's American Baptist Home Mission Societies support. And those are communities that are right here in the United States and in Puerto Rico. So we hope that you will be generous and give to that. Copies of the annual report are out in the court, and as you know, following our service this morning, we will be meeting in person and on Zoom for our annual meeting. But ballots have been collected, and if you did not send in a ballot and you are a member of our church, you may fill out a ballot, and Carol Schaefer, our clerk, will receive that, and she'll be counting up those ballots before we begin our meeting. The rummage rooms are still hoping to be open to the public. It all depends on how things are going with the COVID pandemic. Donations, again, are being accepted by appointment only. Please contact Claudia or Mel if you would like to make an appointment to donate. And they will let us know when things change, when it can be open for shopping. Offering envelopes are still available in the court, so if you have not picked up yours, please be sure to do that. Reminders again that our newsletter is going to be mailed mostly through email, so if you need a paper copy mailed, please let Melissa in the office know. And a reminder that our grief support group is still meeting. Claudia is administrating that through email. And if you have any questions, would like to be included, please contact Claudia. Pretty soon, it is going to be the season for Lent. On February 17th, that's a Wednesday, we will begin with an Ash Wednesday service. We will have that, like we do on Sunday mornings, we will have it in person and online. And ashes will not be dispersed by the pastor because of the COVID guidelines and because some just won't be here with us for that service. And so ashes are going to be divided up in small little containers, and if you would like a set of ashes, please be sure to let me know or call the church office for that. We have a whole lineup for the season of Lent. We are going to begin that Ash Wednesday evening with a Bible study, which will be held on Zoom, and we are going to be studying The Grace of Les Miserables. So if you have seen that movie, this will be an excellent study. We're going to be studying six characters and how God's grace worked in those characters' lives. If you have not seen the movie, I have a DVD that you can borrow. You can also see it on Netflix if you have a subscription to that, or you can rent or buy it as a Prime member on Amazon Prime. That study is going to begin, as I said, on February 17th, Wednesday evening, and it'll run from 6:30 to 8 o'clock. So if you need a study guide, I have six on hand, but you can also order those through Cokesbury and Amazon. They're a little less expensive on Cokesbury, so that might be the way to go there. And then, of course, we'll be thinking about Palm Sunday and Maundy Thursday. And Good Friday, I've prepared a service that will be pre-recorded and uploaded to Facebook and to YouTube. So you can take advantage of that. And Easter Sunday, we hope that we can have that in person. We are also going to make that available through Facebook Live, as we usually do every Sunday morning. Whew. Well, those are a lot of announcements, and so why don't we take a moment now and prepare our hearts for worship? Please join me now in our call to worship. Something inside, so strong, pulls us, beckons us. Some presence in the still of the night. A sense of peace on a frantic day. A fragment of a dream that bears much promise. Something inside so strong steadies us, calms us. A quiet confidence that we will make it through. A growing faith that we are not alone. A sense of wonder that opens new vistas. Something inside so strong calls us to this place. Something so strong causes us to sing your praises. Please pray with me. O God, we come before you empty. Fill us with faith, with a faith of childlike simplicity and persuasive vitality. Fill us with hope, and with a hope that never falters because it is rooted in your constancy. Fill us with love, love for you whom we cannot see, love for loved ones and friends of whom we cannot see enough, love for the unlovely whom we pretend not to see. Bountiful God, fill us once again with faith, hope, and love, that we may more steadfastly and more effectively serve you, whose we are, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Sometimes musically, it's interesting to take a song that you've known for years and years and years and change it just a little bit to have it maybe make more of an impact. So I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene is typically written in 4/4 time. But today I'm going to be playing it in 3/4 time. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful. And my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me, it was in the garden he prayed, not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful am my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages,
to sing of His love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful Lamb, my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
How wonderful, how marvelous is God's love for us. And God listens to us as we pray. And so we want to bring all of our joys and concerns before the throne of grace and pray for those. Thankfully, we have not had any new recent prayer joys or concerns. I should say, thankfully for the concerns, but we're always excited and happy to receive the joys. So let us go to the Lord in prayer and pray all the things that is on our hearts. Please pray with me. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you for meeting us here wherever we are, gathered in this sanctuary and gathered in the sanctuaries at home or anywhere that people are joining us online this morning. Lord, we trust that you are working in and through all of the circumstances of our lives, that you are ever present in this world from east and west, north and south, every point on this globe. And so collectively, Lord, we lift up the world. We pray, dear God, that you would work through the vaccinations that have been prepared and given, that COVID would no longer hold us in bondage to social distancing and being ever cautious and concerned. Lord, we thank you for all those who work on the front lines of COVID, developing vaccines, making sure they get to people on time, doctors, nurses, all medical staff. And Lord, we pray too for those who are struggling with that disease. We pray for their healing. And Lord, we ask that you would walk beside and comfort those who have lost loved ones to this terrible pandemic. Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray your blessings, your grace, your wisdom in the new administration and all of the places where decisions, governmental decisions need to be made that affect all of us. Lord, we pray for our communities in which we live. Show us opportunities to make a contribution, to be a blessing, to reach out to others, especially those who are in need. We pray for our families and our friends who are facing all kinds of challenges, whether it be burnout from work, burnout from COVID, whether it be difficult decisions that may need to be made, we ask your guidance and your wisdom. We pray for all who are sick, for your healing. We pray for those who are distraught or lonely, those who are held in the bondage of depression and addictions. We ask for your release and your wholeness for each one who struggles with those. Lord, we pray for our churches and our ministries. We ask your blessing upon First Baptist Church in Cuba, New York, that you would prosper us in the ministries that you call us to. We pray that our lives would proclaim your gospel, that others would be drawn to you. Oh, Lord God, we also lift to you on this day those desires and concerns that we have not mentioned to others. And we thank you, Lord, that you know us so well, that you know what those are. And so we lift those to you, too. And we pray for our annual meeting that will transpire after our service today. Give us wisdom and insight, and remind us that we are your church. We belong to you. And so, Lord, may all that we do be a praise and an honor and a blessing to your name. In the strong name of Jesus, in whose name we have prayed, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Lord, listen to your children pray. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Send us love, send us love, send us grace.
Sermon title is Not Giving Up, and I think it's going to be a good word for us today as we continue to soldier on in the midst of COVID. And the scripture reading is the second letter from Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. Listen for God's word to you as I read. So we're not giving up. How could we? Even though on the outside it often looks like things are falling apart on us, on the inside, where God is making new life, not a day goes by without his unfolding grace. These hard times are small potatoes compared to the coming good times, the lavish celebration prepared for us. There's far more here than meets the eye. The things we see now are here today, gone tomorrow. But the things we can't see now will last forever. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We are not giving up. Here at last, the last Sunday, the last day of the month, the first month of the new year. Did you think, as I did, that by now we would be well past the pandemic and all the uncertainty, fear, weariness, and separation it has imposed upon us since March of last year. Didn't you think we'd be past it by now? I sure did. So I want to ask you a few questions. Are you feeling like I do, that you cannot take one more piece of bad news about this world or our national scene and all of the contention, the injustices, and violences? Don't you wish it would just all stop? Or are you carrying a burden so heavy, yet so undefinable, that you cannot wrap your head around it? So I want to ask you, how are you? How are you? Last Sunday after our service, someone asked me, "How are you, Lynn?" Without hesitation, I answered, "I'm doing all right. I often feel weary, overwhelmed, but I'm doing okay." At the time, I believed that was the truth. But I thought about that nagging question all week long. And I also thought about my answer to it. And I came to the conclusion that even though I cannot put my finger on it, I am not as fine as I thought I was. And truthfully, I would like to just give up. The challenges, the isolation, the social limitations, and the world situation are just too much. Do you feel like giving up too? I have a feeling that the church folks in Corinth and the Apostle Paul also had good cause to feel like giving up. You see, Paul had founded the church in Corinth on his second missionary journey, and he worked among them for a year and a half. Corinth was known to be a tempestuous city, full of fighting between cultures and religious and political groups. It was also considered to be full of debauchery, which meant that the people of Corinth were extremely indulgent in sensuality and in orgies. Corinth was known as a much welcomed home for harlots and fornicators. We know that from Paul's letters that the church in Corinth also had to deal with these factions, not only inside the church, but outside as well. I should have said it the other way for more emphasis. They also had to deal with it inside their church community. This weighed heavily upon Paul as he wrote them while he was ministering in Ephesus. So let's consider Paul for a moment. The Bible Knowledge Commentary tells us that not too many months before coming to Corinth to establish that church, Paul had been beaten and jailed in Philippi. And then he had been hounded out of Thessalonica and Berea by irate Jews who did not like his message. To make matters just as bad, a sizable community of Jews resided in Corinth. So for Paul, Corinth would not have seemed a likely field in which the seed of gospel could find fertile soil. Even though Paul may have been very fearful of the Jewish community in Corinth, Acts chapter 18, verses 9 through 11, tells us that he went as the Lord had directed. One night, the Lord said to Paul in a vision, "Do not be afraid, but speak and do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one will lay a hand on you to harm you, for there are many in this city who are my people." And so Paul stayed a year and 6 months teaching the word of God among them. Later, while in Ephesus, Paul heard the news of the many struggles with false teachers, indulgences, and conflict that the fledgling church was having. Added to that was their weakness for being impressed by eloquence of speech superior human wisdom, and spectacular gifts of speaking in tongues. This was all noted by Paul in his first letter to the Corinthians. So in truth, the believers in Corinth were walking by sight rather than by faith. Paul was having to put out the many fires of dissension and false beliefs within the church. They were in danger of giving up their faith if they could not see God at work in their midst. This must have wearied Paul terribly. I can't help but wonder if Paul ever felt like giving up on them. I imagine the words that he wrote. Our scripture lesson for today strengthened him as well. So I want to ask you again, how are you? Is there anything in your life that you are wanting to give up on? Does it feel like the world you used to know is falling apart? Do you feel like you're wasting away, that you cannot contribute anything of value again? When you look around, do you feel like what you valued now seems worthless? Are you walking by sight rather than by faith? Sometimes when I get stuck in the walking by sight and wanting to give up, it's helpful to hear the stories of others when they were feeling the same way. One of those light bearers, and pardon the pun, is Thomas Edison. After more than 10,000 attempts at inventing the incandescent light bulb before he was successful, Thomas Alva Edison said, "Many of life's failures are people who did not realize how close they were to success when they gave up." In other words, we can't see how close we really are when we give up. Thank goodness Thomas never gave up. He gave the gift of light to a dark world. He persevered. For some reason, though, I always come back to the perseverance of Paul, who described all his setbacks in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 24 through 27. He says, "Five times I have received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I received a stoning. Three times I was shipwrecked for a night and a day. I was adrift at sea, on frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, danger from bandits, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers and sisters, in toil and hardship, through many a sleepless night, hungry and thirsty, often without food, cold and naked." Wow. Don't you just want to give up for Paul? He went through a lot. For most of us, though, getting through a day or a week or a year is about all the perseverance that we can muster. Working, raising children, babysitting for children, and being involved in mission and personal interests fills all of our time. And certainly, the challenges of living in and dealing with a world of pandemic layers even more pressure on each of us. Perseverance, after all, is not limited to maneuvering through crises or disaster, but enduring the day after day faithfulness to get up and do what's needed, regardless of the obstacles. As Newt Gingrich, former Speaker of the House of Representatives, said, "Perseverance is the hard work you do after you get tired of doing the hard work you already did." I think that says it all. This is the reason for this weariness that we could not put a name to. We have been persevering through many hardships for a very long time. And so we must say and believe with Paul when he said, "These hard times are small potatoes comparing to the coming good times, the lavish celebration prepared for us. There's far more here than meets the eye. The things we see now are here today, gone tomorrow. But the things we can't see now will last forever." Perhaps the next time someone asks, "How are you?" we may answer, "I'm so weary in persevering, but I'm not giving up." Let us pray. Oh Lord, many of us, most of us, I would dare say, are weary. This pandemic has put pressure in so many ways, Lord God. And so I ask that you would help us to put on those eyeglasses of faith, that we would not be fooled by what things look like in our own determination, but that we would trust that you are seeing something very, very different, and you give us that vision as well. Help us, Lord, when we want to give up, when we just want to hibernate, crawl away, put the covers over our heads, and not deal with the things that we must deal with day in and day out. Lord, help us to be prayer warriors who pray the vision of your future. Lord, we trust you that you are with us each and every moment, especially in those times of discouragement when we don't feel your presence at all. Help us to continue to stake our claim on you, O God. For you are Lord of this whole earth, and there is nothing that we can't bring to you that you will not move, take care of, according to your will, according to your love. So help us, Lord, to rest when we need to rest, and to arise again, to follow your will, to proclaim your gospel, to bless all and be a blessing to all we meet. We thank you and praise you, Lord God, that you are doing far more in and through each of us than we could ever ask for, imagine, or even see. To you be all the glory and praise. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious day that grace appeared, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, ransom me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever.
Let us now offer up our praise and dedication to the Lord and the offerings that we have brought. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you for meeting every need. Whether we see it met or not, Lord, we trust you and we thank you. And we thank you that you call us to service, to serve our brothers and sisters and strangers and everywhere you would send our gifts, Lord God. We ask that you would receive our gifts, Lord, including our own persons, our own selves. We ask that you would receive us too. And Lord, we pray that you would bless it, all of it, multiply it, and send it forth, O God, to work your life-giving miracles in the world, to meet needs, to bless those who suffer, to build up your church in every place, to proclaim your mighty name. We offer our gifts to you, O Lord, in Christ's name, amen. And now let us stand for the doxology.
Him, all creatures here below, praise Him above the heavenly world.
And now go forth into this day, knowing that the burdens that you carry are light, for Christ carries them with you. Go forth and trust him, seeing what he is doing in your lives and in the world. And all of God's people say, amen. Amen.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free, for his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.